Don't you worry.
Test, 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 test. Cordless mic one. Cordless mic one. Podium cordless, podium cordless. Test, test. Mic one. That's a little low. Q&A mic one. Q&A mic one. Mic one.
Yeah,
Q&A mic one.
Alright, so everything's on and transmitting on the cordless stuff.
Lapel mic one. Okay. Lapel mic one.
Trying to wake myself.
Speaker lapel mic. Good morning, Oasis. Speaker lapel mic one. Good morning, Oasis. Lapel mic one. 1, 2, 3.
I might even, why not? I didn't write it, but we don't know who wrote it, so.
All right. Am I broadcasting?
Okay, you're a little hot.
Can you walk over here? You're a little hot. Can you turn it down a little? Can you just say, good morning, my name is?
Okay, talking in a normal voice now, and I don't know what's... People are kind of looking up and back, so... Yeah, what do you think? I'm not getting any...
Volumes and CR subjects, yeah.
And you can put a little tape there if you want.
I think I will. Joke.
Check, podium mic check.
Yeah, love ain't a thing. Love is a verb. Love ain't a thing. Love is a verb.
Sorry. Oh, okay.
Okay.
No, you can't get through love.
Stronger than our minds. Story of our lives is written right on our hands, with every scar and callus you can find. These hands are bruised and battered by the walls I've broken down. Every broken dream, like iron, to catch a daughter's tears. These hands are working wood and steel and saw. When these hands give up the ghost, then I lay this body down. God bless these hands. Bless these hands. God bless these hands. Working to the work and they were done. These hands have cradled babies. These hands have cradled guns. These hands have pounded nails and punished sons. When these hands give up the ghost, then I lay this body down. God bless these hands. Bless these hands. God bless these hands. Secrets of her body in the night. These hands hold this guitar to my chest like a lover. Bring the music of my soul into the light. When these hands give up the ghost, then I lay this guitar down. God bless these hands. Bless these hands. God bless these hands. Let my spirit shine. Bless these hands.
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to Houston Oasis. My name is Alexis Potterman. I'll be your MC for today. Welcome, everybody. Like I said, my name is Alexis Potterman. I'll be your MC today. Behind me, you can see some of our core values, and I like to start off by highlighting a couple of them every week. Today, I want to highlight reality is known through reason. meaning comes from making a difference. We've got a great lineup for you today. We have the legendary Ken Gaines and Wayne Wilkerson who will be playing for us today. And our main speaker is Dr. Leinhard from Engines of Our Ingenuity. So let's go ahead and get this morning started with a couple songs from our musicians.
We're ready to roll. It's good not to not be. You're not getting a signal from me.
We'll get there. It used to work.
I can get up here and just vamp for a minute. Just for those of you who know me, I've been emceeing for Oasis for several years, and I almost never, ever start on time, ever. So today I was really happy because I was starting on time. Probably. I don't know. I can hear it kind of.
Straight into the EQ.
I already tried to do that. You mean, well, what's the difference between doing that and this?
Well, if the patch between that and the EQ is bad.
Okay, let's try that. Okay. Get anything? I can take orders. I'm trainable.
If it works, we'll do it, no problem.
understand. One of those things that we're just not used to these days. Got another mic stand?
Yes, they're coming.
Okay, good. So, just getting things rolling. Earlier, I gave you a little hint of what I was going to play. I don't know if I've ever played this song for you folks. That's a cool mic stand.
Can you get one more? Yeah.
That's. The song I started out with my it's basically my mic check song, which worked when I was doing a mic check song, is a song I've been doing as my mic check song for about 3 or 4 decades. Crank it up there, buddy. And I first heard this song in 1967. The Dick Clark Show. Been played by the Youngbloods. Anybody remember the Youngbloods? Couple of hands there. Come on, people, now get together. Well, they played that song and then they played this one. I thought it was one of the coolest things I ever heard. Flash forward about 30 years. I get to hear the great blues man, Paul Jeremiah. Rochester, New York, and dang if he didn't play this song. Pulled him over later on and said, man, I think it's cool you doing all those old blues songs, then you do that Youngblood song. He said, what you talking about? That's the way he talks, he's a blues man. I said, that Grizzly Bear song, he said, man, that song goes back to 1915. We have no idea who wrote that song, but it is danceable. Yeah, when I woke up this morning, she was gone, 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 gone. And she would not even tell me the reason why. How she loved to dance that old Grizzly Bear. I guess she's gone to Frisco to dance it there. Because when I woke up this morning, she was gone, she was solid gone. And she made me sad. Oh, I felt so bad. And she would not even tell me the reason why. She loved to dance that old Grizzly Bear. I guess she's gone to Frisco to dance it there. Because when I woke up this morning, she was gone, solid gone. Take it away, Wayno. Let's hear it for Wayne Wilkerson on guitar. We're just gonna do one song for this. It took so long. That cool? Yeah, she made me sad. Oh, I felt so bad. And you would not even tell me the reason why. How she loved to dance that old Grizzly Bear. I guess she's gone.
risk all the doubts in there, because when I woke up this morning, she was gone. She was solid gone. Yeah, when I woke up this morning, she was gone. She was solid gone. That's what they say back in 15. Solid gone.
Solid gone.
Thank you very much. Since it took so long, we're just going to do the one song at the beginning, or do you want two songs? You want two? All right, we're still doing that. I guess we'll have to stay loud, huh? I think it's this one. All right, here's a road song. Way out here on this highway, with nothing else but time, between the last stop and the next one down the line. It's a simpler way of living and a simpler way to see, leaving all my worldly cares behind. Way out here, I can see it all so clearly. Way out here, where the mountains meet the sky, how everyone I love, all that I hold dear, come together in the distance way out here. Together in the distance way out here. Somewhere behind me is the man I used to be, lost before I knew him as a friend. Somewhere out in front I know is waiting there for me, as I sweep across the circle once again. Way out here, I can see it all so clearly. Way out here, where the mountains meet the sky, how everyone I love, all that I hold dear, come together in the distance way out here. Together in the distance way out here. Brings to bear. I'd lift my eyes and sing this little prayer. Y'all can sing it too. Here we go. Way out here, I can see it all so clearly. Way out here, where the mountains meet the sky, how everyone I love, all that I hope, come together in the distance way out here. Together in the distance way out here.
And it be what it be. Thank you all very much.
I know many of you are very excited for this talk today. Some of you might be joining us for the first time. So we will welcome Dr. Lienhard up here in a moment to do his main talk. We'll do a quick coffee break, and then we'll come back after the coffee break to give y'all lots of time for Q&A, because I'm sure many of you will have lots of questions or just want to put it, as one Oasis said, fangirl out a little bit. So, so our main speaker today is Dr. John Lienhard, Professor Emeritus of Mechanical Engineering at University of Houston and creator of the radio program, The Engines of Our Ingenuity. His talk today is titled, Why the Industrial Was a Revolution, and discusses the dramatic civilization progress made during the Industrial Age in Europe and areas of art, literature, philosophy, and the following QR code that is in your program gives you access to a lot of his additional resources and sources. So please help me welcome up here Dr. Lienhard.
Okay, am I audible? Well, before I begin, I want to thank Roy and Wayne. I really enjoyed that. I was sort of sorry that you had to quit and I had to begin. That was... By the way, I have a story for somebody who wrote a piece called Einstein's Violin. My wife is a violinist, and early in the game, she was studying with her teacher who had once played string quartets with Einstein. And he told the tale of turning on the fellow and saying, Albert, for God's sake, can't you count? But anyway, that doesn't appear in your song, I don't. I want to thank you for having me here. And now, if I understand correctly, you all have a concern with how technology and science both shape and are influenced by our complex world, for good and for ill. That's why I hope you'll find it useful to look at what I might call the second scientific revolution. And it begins with what we commonly call the Industrial Revolution. We're all very aware of the 17th century scientific revolution, Kepler, Galileo, Bacon, Newton, Hooke, all those guys. But science underwent another huge shift at the turn of the 19th century. That's because a seismic change was then upending all of human thinking. This morning, I would like to claim that the shift centered on what we've come to call the Industrial Revolution. But here we run into trouble. The term gets thrown around pretty haphazardly. I'm sure you've heard Henry Ford included in it. Well, industrialization was a very old hat by the time Ford built his assembly lines. While Ford is clearly a stretch, historians generally do extend the Industrial Revolution well into the 19th century, and that makes perfect sense up to a point, but it misses the revolution part of it. The word revolution suggests a historical turning point, a fulcrum, and one thing that everyone does get right is the timing of that turning point. The Industrial Revolution began at the end of the 18th century, I'm sorry. And James Watt's radical steam engine improvements were central to it. But that was just the most visible part of an iceberg. This morning, I'll ask you to join me in a look at so much that lay that iceberg's waterline. You see, the events of the late 18th century went far beyond new machinery. What we call the Industrial Revolution really was a revolution That's because it took place in a time of social, political, religious, intellectual, technological, philosophical, and artistic upheaval. It was a moment when the world really turned upon its ear. And Watt's engines, well, they were some of the more visible first fruits of all that. So, let's look at what happened just before it began. Western Europeans were fed up with authoritarian rulers, tired of both political authority. That authority had been gaining strength for a long time. It was ripe to be overturned. Earlier, the Edict of Fontainebleau ended France's legal recognition of Protestants. Most of them were a Calvinist sect called Huguenots. So Huguenots fled France into Holland, North America, and other countries. Many became important intellectuals and tradesmen in England. At the same time, many English left their own Anglican church to become Methodist, Anabaptist, Unitarian, and much more. It was largely religious dissidents who began taking control of the economy away from the central government in London. Their first important act was to build a system of canals throughout England and into Wales, Scotland, even Ireland. That began in the mid-18th century, and it soon was a 4,000-mile network for moving goods, complete with viaducts and locks. Those tradesmen now had new means for creating wealth and taking control of the economy. This was not yet a revolution. Just commerce-minded people quietly gaining control. People in other countries weren't as well equipped to create that kind of economic independence. Here in America, the American, we built toward the American Revolution as we seethed against taxation. The French likewise followed us toward their own revolution. And revolution began festering in other countries as well. And Great Britain was now about to face not one but two revolutions, one in America and one at home. And the one at home, their industrial revolution, would be the only bloodless one. Now, the oddest element that went into the revolution is feedback control. Feedback control is the means by which you read some output, a temperature, a flow rate, a rotational speed. Then we convert that output into a signal that opposes the input. A thermostat reads the room's temperature. It then uses that reading to oppose the way things are going. If the temperature corrects the that the only useful feedback is negative feedback. And we must here. A child runs into the street and I say, oh, Mary, you ran into here, have an M&M. That's pure positive feedback, reinforcing the deviation instead of countering it. That's why a yes man is constructive in the workplace. Doomed all its employees pulled together toward the CEO's vision. Negative feedback is the blood of any healthy organization, and it began 2.5 centuries ago. Business and tradespeople had said, in effect, we shall build new technologies that will create better lives. And as they did so, negative feedback appeared quite literally in the very machinery they built. Some examples. First, I need to point out that France was different, and its revolution occurred had to be violent. Everything, and that regulation was tighter than England's industrial revolution could never have gained traction in France. Power. Mind is a steam engine. He built in 17. He'd pretty well biographer James Boswell visited the Bolton Wall in 76. James Watt's engines. Bolton said, "I hear, sir, what all the world desires, power." That was a clear double entendre, mixing energy production with decision-making power. Well, why not? The two are clearly linked. And here feedback reappears in its most literal sense. One example, Watt's later engines walked away behind a metal screen. Feature because he was unsure of the of it. He didn't have it stolen. It was his flexible governor. Heavy metal balls hang from rods at a pivot point in on about a vertical axis. The speed of the engine drives that rotation. When the engine turns too slowly, they hang downward, causing a mechanism to open the steam throttle. When they spin rapidly, they swing upward and close the steam valve down. Here was negative feedback in its purest form. Today, mechanisms that sense a discrepancy and correct it are everywhere in our world. Float valves in our toilets, thermostats in our rooms, all kinds of feedback control runs through our automobiles. This ubiquitous part of our lives was non-existent when Watt was a little boy. And yet, feedback had actually been widespread 2,000 years earlier in Hellenistic North Africa. But that was during another stunning age of invention and experimentation. Alexander the Great died in 325 BC. His empire didn't last, but he left behind him a stirred-up world, a polycultural society now sprang up around the Eastern Mediterranean basin. It was a freewheeling mixing pot with Alexandria, Egypt at its intellectual center. Euclid and Archimedes worked in Alexandria, and so did engineers who created all kinds of feedback control devices. Take the self-regulating wine bowl. Guests would dip wine from a bowl, but the bowl would remain full no matter how much they took. Well, it had the same mechanism that tells your plumbing to refill your toilet tank. Same linkages, same stopper to block the flow when the bowl or the tank is full. Those Hellenistic engineers invented the water clock, and it used a feedback-controlled flow of water to raise a float at a constant rate. And that water clocks became the best timepieces of that era. Such machines were widespread in the Hellenistic world, and now, consider something about these gadgets and about negative feedback itself. Self-regulating machines bring us back to that matter of decision-making. When we let go of the knob, we relinquish control. Make no mistake, that idea is abhorrent to totalitarian thinking. And sure enough, feedback control disappeared when Rome took control of the Levant, Eastern Mediterranean. That anti-corrective mindset was very strong in 18th century Europe. Think about the French kings and their top-down view of control. At the same time, think about how that view reflected in their fetish for elaborate clocks and clockwork toys. Wind them up and they obeyed their preset commands without a shred of feedback. Speaking of clockwork, I'm sure many of you are opera lovers. How many of you are opera lovers? Ah, got a few. No? No. he's not. Well, okay. I am. So if you're familiar with Mozart's opera Figaro, he used as his text a play written by one of King Louis XIV's clockmakers, Count Beaumarchais. Beaumarchais, like Mozart himself, was actually a closet revolutionary. His rebellious servant Figaro mutters to his master, "You may go dancing, but I'll play the tune." He lets us know that he's going to correct Count Almaviva's clock. Mozart made that line famous in 1786, a scant 10 years after Watt's first steam engine, and about the time he was finishing the improvements of his machine. Meanwhile, the French mercantile economic system reflected the same mechanical clock concept of economic control. Let's see how that worked. The mercantile idea, and Sarah, correct me if I oversimplify here, was that nations stipulate trade balances ahead of time. It assumed that the nation had colonies to provide raw materials and gold. A working class manufactured goods within the country. Those goods were then sold back to the colonies. Meanwhile, the wants of the working class had to be minimized and its population increased. Now, is that not a formula calculated to drive any overregulated populace into revolution, both at home and abroad? But English tradesmen saw that goods were the property of the people who made those goods to both use and sell, while those rural dissidents of their canal network and claimed the goods that they made, they also laid hold of invention. Their inventions had been part of their game ever since a blacksmith, Newcomen, invented the first working steam engine way back in 1712. All that was a huge violation of the clockwork mercantile equation, and sure enough, it's in this gathering revolution that feedback suddenly welled up for the second time. As early as 1745, a blacksmith, Edmund Lee, invented the fantail windmill. It had a second fan perpendicular to the main fan. It turned when the wind shifted, rotating the turret, which held the main fan, until it faced straight into the wind. Perfect feedback. The first flush toilet with its feedback control tank refilling, it was invented in England in 1778, just 2 years after Watt's first engine. But all that's just machinery. The most famous feedback process was far more startling. David Hume had used the idea in a remarkable and completely new way. Hume laid out a theory of self-regulation of the international money market in 1752. He said that if a nation's price levels are lower than its neighbors, its exports will rise, and that brings in more money. But it also causes price levels to rise. Then the export goods drop, and so on. Here was a pure feedback description of the economy, and it was Hume's friend Adam Smith who really developed that thinking a few years later. He issued his feedback laissez-faire economic model, and of course laissez-faire translates, it's not really a French word exactly, is it? It's sort of taken to mean something like let nature take its course or let things manage themselves. Smith published his definitive challenge to mercantilism, the wealth of nations, in 1776. Look at how that date keeps coming at us. His book was very radical thinking. It was not only pure feedback, it was pure revolution as well. And think of this. The language of that idea also runs through the American Constitution, which was developed just as Watt was perfecting his new steam engines. The checks and balances that we prize so highly are the control valves of a constitutional system. They are more examples of pure feedback control. We sought to take power away from princes and other leaders. God, how I hate that word, leader, but that's another talk for another day. We gave power over to a feedback controller, our constitution. In doing so, we set up the machinery by which we could regulate ourselves, and so I ask you to look at the timing here. We completed what the Declaration of Independence began at the same time Watt was completing the series of inventions that gave us modern steam power. We had our Declaration of Independence, Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations, James Watt's first commercial steam engine, all in the single year 1776. It all seemed to move in lockstep, and one more 1776 event really made that date a turning point in human history. This was a shift in philosophical and scientific thinking. That shift began with philosopher Immanuel Kant's Critique of Pure Reason, published in 1776, Until then, Newton's clockwork universe had been ascended. Now, we could rationally predict everything. Rationally predict everything. The mercantile French loved Newton, by the way. Science became a business of data collecting and then rationalizing those data. But Kant said, wait a minute, wait a minute. Ultimate reality is a Ding an sich. That's German for a thing in itself, forever unreachable by human experience. We have only what our senses tell us about reality. We poor sense-limited human creatures. We create the best intellectual structures we can, but neither reason nor empiricism can ever carry us to ultimate truth. Modern era physicists have increasingly pointed to this inescapable limitation. Almost a century ago, Niels Bohr was explicit in pointing this out. He made a very disquieting remark. He said, clarity and truth are incompatible. Whoops. Another physicist of his time said, reality as we see it is rather like the dragon's breath, but it is the dragon itself. Others have pointed to Plato's allegory of the cave. Do you know that one? The group of people are chained inside a cave and all they see of external reality are shadows cast by people passing before a fire and casting a shadow on the cave wall. From those shadows, they form the only concept of reality that is possible for them. Well, now we have physics experiments that suggest unreachable realities really do affect what we can actually see and measure. Do take a look at the video in my sources. I offer a video that goes on for a while. It expands on this idea, and it really is excellent. And Kant's ideas continue to take on flesh and blood. Now, Kant was content with Newton's own science. Sir Isaac had, after all, reached down into his psyche and pulled up theoretical models that work. But remember, when people asked Newton why his law of gravity was true, he answered, I don't make hypotheses. He knew he was dealing with truths beyond his understanding. Kant's problem was not with Newton. It was with sort of paint-by-numbers rationalist view of reality that people had tried to build upon Newton's science. Reality, said Kant, is not nearly so formulaic. Now, the ones who really took up that idea were the English Romantic poets. You think I'm joking. Of all people, they said something very odd. They said, we create nature by dreaming nature. What did that mean? Well, they, like Kant, realized that Newton had not created his science by following threads of pure logic, not by any means. He had instead looked inside his own head to create mathematical structures. And those structures described only as much of reality as we could see. So while British science had, by 1776, turned to rituals of cataloging observations, the earliest British Romantic poet, William Blake, said something much different. You're probably familiar with the words he wrote in 1790, I will not cease from mental fight, nor shall the sword sleep in my hand till we have built Jerusalem in England's green and pleasant land. Blake went on to make it clear that mental fight was the reconstruction of the external world within the mind. He really is reflecting Kant when he suggests that mental fight is the way to understanding. What followed in the early 19th century was the Romantic literary movement. Coleridge, Byron, Shelley, Keats, Wordsworth, and more. These poets knew and talked with scientists of the period. They had a powerful influence upon them. Science and poetry got peculiarly intermixed during that time. Later on, the German Romantic period, Goethe was a scientist himself, scientific writings. William Wordsworth, as much as anyone, pointed the way. He had written this in his poem, Tintern Abbey. With an eye made quiet by the power of harmony and the deep power of joy, we see into the life of things. That's exactly what happened, you see. Soon a whole new breed of theorists, their eyes made quiet by focused thought, did see into the life of things, things that lay beyond the simple bounds of reason alone. I hope I'm not treading on toes here. Anyway, Faraday, Davy, Tyndall, Maxwell, Clausius, Boltzmann, Gibbs, Darwin, Helmholtz, so many others. They changed the very face of science. The world has never seen such scientific change as it did between Dalton's atomic theory, 1803, and Einstein's relativity in 1905. Understand what happened here. All these scientists made irrational leaps of the mind. Well, maybe irrational is not quite the right word. Better to say that their leaps of the mind went where rational steps could never have led them. Now, given enough time, I'd like to go on to other changes. A huge shift in the world of art, for example. So much to say there. Just trace the evolution of the painter Joseph Wright of Derby, or the sudden appearance of Turner's art not long after 1776. But I think you get the point. What we call the Industrial Revolution was in reality an upheaval in human thinking. That naming is okay. Industrial was surely a part of it, but I tell you, 1776 was a fulcrum date after which human thought itself was rebuilt. The effects of the many events that took place around that date spun outward in the century that followed. We went into that period thinking one way, we came away a changed people. The revolution was sudden, but it echoed down through the 19th century and beyond. And so I will stop here, and I look forward, I guess we take a coffee break first. I look forward to hearing what you all have to say about this. Thank you.
That was a fantastic talk. We'll take a about a five minute coffee break, and then we'll come back for some Q&A.
Lay me down in Marble Town, a boneyard. was a bad bull on the railroad. Tried to put me off his train. There's a bad bull on the railroad. Tried to put me off his train. Lay me down in Marble Town till the coast is clear again. We got a man down here, we got a man down, we got a man down here, we got a man down. I'm gonna fit me a cannonball that won't stop for any. Fit me a cannonball, I won't stop for anyone. Lay me down in Marble Town, wait till morning comes. I'm gonna roll out here in the tombstone, wait here on my train. Roll out here in the tombstone. We got a man down here, we got a man down, we got a man down here, we got a man down. Roll out here, mister.
Yesterday I thought that I walked alone, and that love was just a night. But a nightingale followed me back home, where my love was waiting.
Touch the ground without a sound. I wonder why you had to leave. Neon signs down on Broadway. Memories of our first kiss. Lovers hand in hand. The sound of a band. Feelings I can't dismiss. Oh, so many times it happens, and I know it'll happen once again. I see you on the street, our eyes suddenly meet, then you're gone like the wind. Tapping on my window, whose skies have turned to gray. They touch the ground, my world's upside down. Wonder why you stay away. Oh, turn back the days, turn back the weeks, turn back the hands of time.
All right, everybody. Got a lot of great conversations happening.
Test. Q&A mic check. Q&A mic check. Q&A mic check. Q&A 2 mic check.
All right. If we can take our seats, we can get started with the Q&A. We've got I'm sure there'll be lots of questions, and we've got good time for it. I'm actually doing okay on time today, which is never happens, y'all. All right. Do we have any questions to get started with? No questions to get started with. All right. We've got one question over here.
If it's a question, I don't know the answer, but if it's a comment, I'm happy to hear it.
Is it the rules that we're only supposed to do questions and not comments, is that correct? Okay, well, I have to stick by the rules then. And if you don't know, you don't know. That's okay. First off, Dr. John Lerner, thank you for coming to speak. I really enjoyed your talk. I am an alumni of the University of Houston. Go Cougs. So I just have to say that. But I do want to get your comments and your thoughts on the role of organized labor and labor unions.
Of what?
The role of organized labor during the Industrial Revolution.
Organized which?
Labor. As labor. Labor unions. Yeah, labor unions. Workers coming together. And the difference, I guess, if you see any difference between the quality of life of a steel worker in 1885, when unions were just starting to form, versus 1955, when unions were relatively strong. I just want to get your comments on that.
Yeah. It's interesting. America became socialized in the mid-19th century. We developed any number of socialistic institutions. The public lending library came in just about that time. and police forces and general public education for everybody. All of these things kind of converged in the mid-19th century. And that was the time when Marx and those guys started talking about giving power to labor unions and such. So there was really a point in American history where all of this just suddenly kerblammo emerged kind of with a rush. Now, getting back to the Industrial Revolution or the late 18th century, I'm not really equipped to say much there. I do know that labor remained vulnerable, and if you get into the early 19th century, industrialization started creating the workers' hell that Dickens wrote about. And I should point out there, though, there's another interesting wrinkle, and that is that these industrialists really were looking to create better lives for workers. Wedgwood, for example, we make a big fuss over his fancy dishware, but his main product was cheap tableware that workers could buy and use. And these people met in the evening once a month in the Lunar Society, so-called, and actually plotted ways to make industrialization work for a general public. I don't know if that answers your question.
All right, any additional questions?
Yeah, sir. Talk loud. Oh, okay.
I guess the best way to do this is steal a quote. How do you believe that we can survive our technological adolescence and keep our humanity intact?
Well, I don't know that we can.
I don't want to hear that.
Maybe we're on the verge of exterminating ourselves. And we talk about climate change, which is, you know, a huge problem, but there's an even huger problem underlying that, and that is population, which, of course, drives climate change. So I think until we find some way to focus attention on overpopulation, by the way, there is a fundamental cause for overpopulation. It's twofold. It is poverty and lack of education for women. Those two factors drive population. If we can somehow remedy those. And of course, what's driving poverty is increased inequality of income, which is now just almost desperately out of kilter in the United States and in the world in general. Yeah. Pardon me, I'm going in a circle here, but it circles, doesn't it? Yeah.
I feel crazy when I say stuff like that.
Yeah. All right. Shh.
Ma'am.
Just to give you another question, if nobody else had anything. Piggybacking on population in the world, do you have any thoughts on demographics over the next 50 years and what's come out of China and the chances that their population is going to go through a great drop because their population is aging, and the fact that they may have 3 men to every 2 women because of their one-child policy that went on for so long, and so many families wanted boys. Do you have any thoughts on that and how that could affect the world?
Well, the countries where population has not been exploding, of course, have been the wealthy European ones, where people have money and women are educated. And the places where population are exploding are the poor countries. Now, China, of course, did that experiment, and then they found they were creating, as you point out, an aging population, and they backed off. I don't know if they're, are they coming back to it? It seems to me I heard some. Yeah, because they're becoming more wealthy and educated. Yeah. Yeah. So. Yeah, speak.
The discrepancy between the number of women and men of marriageable and childbearing age is so great that the cancer in the current size of the
community. Excuse me.
Sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I shouldn't be sticking my nose in here.
Yeah.
The discrepancy between the number of women and men, I think that's what you're getting at, of childbearing age is so great that their population's going to crash. Demographic experiment.
Yeah, because of what they did, yeah.
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 Anyway, sorry.
Of course, that's true also to some extent in Europe, is it not? Where population, where procreation has fallen off.
There have been times, in France in particular, was the first to lead the way towards demographic transition to very low rates of population
yeah.
growth. And then times during the wars that I study where the deaths were over the number of births.
Yeah.
But they've sort of evened out. I just think the China thing is going to be interesting
yeah, right.
to see.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sir.
Yes, thank you for your talk. But my question involves a statement. Necessity is the mother of invention. Are you all of the belief that in a time like this, when we clearly have more problems than
necessity,
maybe the planet.
Necessity does not drive invention.
Okay, good. Thanks for clarifying that. It's a nice saying. What do you think drives invention then?
I think it is an urge, a desire. I think people invent for the same reason they paint or make music or do any other artistic thing. I think it's a pursuit of pleasure. It's Archimedes running down the street naked saying, Eureka, Eureka. Whether or not it's true, that's what we inventors do when we invent in some way. We're driven, there are two. Invention is hedonistic, and the two drivers are pleasure and freedom. Pleasure and freedom. Interesting thing about if you plot speed of airplanes, they must have gone way up during World War I and World War II. Well, they didn't. They flattened and then gained again in peacetime. War was not driving. What war did was drive people to make fixes. And they were constantly tinkering, trying to fix the airplanes and make them work better. But as far as doing any radical new invention that would result in a better airplane, you know, wartime does not drive invention. Look at all the great inventions that we have. They didn't come out of war. People talk about radar. Radar was around before war. Any of these things. We were splitting atoms before the Manhattan Project. Right? Yeah. Excuse me, before I finish, was that what you wanted to?
Do you think we today have an atmosphere that encourages invention?
What?
Do you think in the Western world, let's limit it to us, there is an environment that is encouraging invention?
Does what encourage invention?
The climate, the environment, of our society, is it encouraging invention, do you think?
Yeah, I think the people that are coming up with ideas that are going to help are people who are interested in the ideas. And now, very often, the inventor will go looking for a need once the inventor has invented. And I think that climate is going to claim a lot of the inventors running around with inventions looking for a need. Yes.
So, yeah, I've always pondered this, and one of the things I've pondered is the establishment clause in the Constitution prevents the government from promoting science as a belief system. What are your thoughts on promoting, maybe having the government be based on science?
The technocrats. By the way, when I was a kid, during the Depression in the 1930s, we'd drive around and we'd see these big billboards here. Technocracy was trying to get political.
Science is not necessarily technology-based. It could be evolutionary psychology, or just plain old evolution.
It may take different forms, but
how people think and emotions explains emotions also.
Sure, replace technocracy with Scientology. Oops. Okay, go ahead. Yes.
No, I'm just saying you have the technological science, but you also have evolutionary science, which explains people's emotions and psychology, and that could explain how people's quality of life also. It's not just technological. So yes, there is. If you only think of the technological aspect, you could see it as being bad, but it's not always.
I'm not quite sure where you're going here. You're talking about a system of government based upon knowledge.
Yes, science and knowledge, exactly.
Yeah. People have
rather
talked
than
about
being neutral
that for years,
towards science and knowledge.
But the problem is science and technology are fluid. They're changing all the time. And you try to form a government on that basis, you're going to have... Look at scientists talking to one another, arguing about what's true and what's false. I think you get into a terrible bind there, because the forefront of science, the forefront of technology is...
Science is self-correcting, though.
Is what?
It's self-correcting.
But if you try to form a government based on that, based upon a fluid knowledge base, it seems to me you're going to be in trouble. Yes?
Couldn't you think of your self-correcting mechanism or the scientific aspect of the system that we have? You make that case.
Self-correcting, yeah. Yeah.
Our constitution is self-correction.
Yes. If you can formulate this governmental structure to see it, I think you'll find that once you start specifying it. Well, I made the remark in the talk that I really hated the word leader, and I think that one of the places that this form of government will come into trouble is the existence of leaders. If you can do it in a leaderless fashion somehow, then yeah, but okay.
I think we've got about time for two more questions, so we'll do.
Yes, sir.
Hi, thank you again for coming. My question, because I did raise my hand when you said who likes opera, is what's your favorite opera?
My favorite opera. It depends on where my mindset is at a given time. You know, sometimes I like Mozart. Sometimes I prefer some of the Baroque forms. It depends on the music in it, the mood I'm in. What would you say if I were to turn upon you and say, what's your favorite piece of music? Wouldn't that be the most fluid?
I would have to.
Yeah.
Yeah, what I'm working on right now is my favorite.
What, exactly. Okay, right. I think, yes, sir.
Thank you for the excellent talk. It was pretty interesting. I have a two-part question. The first one is, you mentioned about the correlation with, art and science, right? And with the art eras, right, from Renaissance to Baroque to Enlightenment and then going back to Romanticism, there seems like there probably was a shift from heavily being religion influenced towards like secular and then going back to maybe more mysticism type thing, right? So do you think that there was a correlation with the technological advancement?
Excuse me, I'm having trouble understanding. A correlation which?
the changes in the art movements, right, from Renaissance to Baroque to Enlightenment, right? So it seems like it went from being heavily influenced with religion or by religion towards a more secular type trend, right? Do you think there was a correlation with the scientific advancements in those eras with that change? And the second part of the question is, like, with today's environment, which direction do you think we're headed next?
Okay, as I understand you, you're sort of talking about the way science advances, sort of the way religion has been advancing, or not advancing, or something. Science was essentially the province of religion until the 18th, the 17th century. I think you would say that. Would you slap my wrist if I did? Yeah. Then we started to create separate institutions. Okay, go ahead. Elaborate your question so I can figure out where to go from there.
I guess I was wondering, so from the Renaissance time, right, and then when it went to Enlightenment, it seemed like there was a revolution, kind of like what you mentioned, right? And I think some of the technological improvement and advancement in science kind of correlated with that period. I might be wrong, but I think there was kind of like a little bit of overlap, right? But then today's world, where do you see that relationship as?
And technology and science?
Art and the popular culture and like, oh. Yeah, being close to religion or being influenced by religion versus being a more secular, progressive thought process.
The answer to your question is, I don't know. I don't know. I'll think about it. Let me think about that. Yeah, that's an interesting question. Will you let me off the hook with that?
Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
And if you do think about it, feel free to email me and share it. Yeah. I did want to let everyone know we do have papers with the QR code if you're interested in learning some more information, his sources, just any curiosity from today. All right. Before we have our final two songs from Ken and Wayne, I do want to invite our newest treasurer for the board up here, Richard Andrews.
It's hard to follow the John Leinhard Act, but this will be very brief, don't worry. So, yeah, I'm the new treasurer, and of course, you're protecting your wallet as soon as you hear that. But we do, I just want just a gentle reminder that we do pay rent here, we pay the musicians, we have some other expenses. So if you're able to, please drop a little something in the black hat back there, and we do have some other ways to give, which are noted back there. So if you're not able to support Oasis a little bit, that's fine. Your presence here is the main thing. Another way you can help, a little thing, is if you're able to bring your own coffee cup, that would be great. That's also environmentally good. Otherwise, great having you here, and it's nice to see a big crowd, and it's nice to see several newcomers. Of course, we welcome the old comers also, so thank you.
And with that, we'll have our final two songs.
And I believe I'm properly powered here. Well, I had to do this song. If time and space are relative, What of love and pain? Does one become the other in the end? Can we find forgiveness in a single drop of rain? Or drift apart inside the solar wind? If we could only play Einstein's violin, would the notes reveal the truth we wish to hold? If we could only play Einstein's violin, would the secrets of the heart unfold? Following a beam of light, slowing down in time, bending with the smallest breath of air. If forever is a single night, spinning on a dime, the smallest touch has energy to spare. If we could only play Einstein's violin, would the notes reveal the truth we wish to hold? If we could only play Einstein's violin, would the secrets of the heart unfold? Reach out and recover yesterday. And if Einstein was right, as we approach the speed of light, to find the feelings not so far away, then maybe in this universe that separates us now, we discover how to fall in love again. Playing Einstein's violin, to discover how to fall in love again. So I like, I was talking to someone and saying that I like having at least two songs together like this because it gives you the opportunity for contrast. So we're going to go from the sublime to the ridiculous. It actually illustrates one of my best songwriting seminars, which I do quite a few of, by the way, and it's called The Power of Contrast. This song started to be about a cool pop I took away from my little brother when we were kids. He was 5, I was 8. That's a big difference. But somewhere on a bus trip with a bunch of kids from the Boys and Girls Club, Club of Central Texas. We were driving from Killeen, Texas to Albuquerque. It was a real school bus. It was killing my back. So I decided I had to do something with my mind. And this guy took over this song. I was writing about this cool pop. I was working with my little brother. I will get back to that cool pop. Here come old razzmatazz. He don't like nothing but jazz. Always saying things like, yeah, crazy. He snap his finger bones. He play air slide trombone. His eyes are deep and dark and hazy. Razzmatazz, they call him razzmatazz. The only name he has, he dress real sweet. And if it don't swing, he don't sing, cause he gotta have a beat. Boom, chick-a-pop a razzmatazz. You picture Razz with sunglasses walking around looking cool singing. Slim Buzz wing on Joseph Wayne. Boom, shake a leg a leg a boom, 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 bow. Wow, that rhymes with wow, wow, that rhymes with how. How, 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 how. Here come old razzmatazz. He don't like nothing but jazz. Girlfriend's name is Bebop, a Lubop, a Daisy. He go his way alone. Ain't got no telephone. Always saying things like, yeah, crazy. Razzmatazz, they call him razzmatazz. The only name he has, he got big feet. And if it don't swing, don't mean a thing. Gotta have a boom-ba-boom-boom. He don't eat meat. They rhyme. Yeah, if it don't swing, don't ring a ding, ding a ding. Gotta have a boom, ba ba loo ba boom, razzmatazz. Gotta have a boom, chicka boom, razzmatazz. Gotta have a do, wagga do, wagga do, wagga do, wagga do. Sometimes Razz walk around saying things like, you know, life is like a cool pop. You remember your first cool pop, man? I do. Patty Tate gave it to me. I was over visiting the Tate sisters, and there was Patty with a big old blue one in her hand. I said, what's that, Patty? She says, that's a cool pop, Kenny. I said, can I have one? She says, sure, Kenny. Little sister Donna gave that little sister laugh, because little sisters know things. Reached in that freezer, pulled out a big old ribbon. I had no idea what to do with that thing, but luckily my little sharp teeth cut through that plastic husk. Got my first taste. Oh, yeah. I ripped that top off and took myself a proper bite. Then I took myself another proper bite. Another bite, another bite, another bite. Man, I could not get enough of that. But then finally, just like all cool pops, all that was left in my hands was that plastic husk with just a little bit of juice down there in the bottom. I could have saved it, put it back in a freezer, but that ain't what life nor cool pops is about. I turn that thing upside down and went, then there I was, finally, with that empty plastic husk in my hands. Big old red smile on my face, my tongue was red. Oh, that was fine. Yeah, that was cool pop. And it gotta have a beat. Yeah, crazy. Thank y'all very much.
Thank you so much. All right. Thank you to Ken and Wayne for your fabulous music. Thank you so much, Dr. Lienhard, for being here today. It was a fabulous talk. And thank you to all of you who are here today, both in person and online. We're glad you're here. And we hope to see you next week. You can also join us after at Tacos de Julio on Westheimer. The address is in the bulletin. Stick around, have some good lunch, have some good talk, and we'll see you all next week.